Hi there, and welcome to the channel of a disappointed man with me, Jason Kennedy, the disappointed man. And on this beautiful Saturday afternoon in Taiwan, I thought I'd talk about illness narratives. A couple of the commenters asked me about why I chose that as the topic of my thesis, and so here is my response. The first thing I'd like to say is I have no morbid interest in being ill, but rather illness and language are tied together in a very interesting way. It's often the fact that an illness is the most significant or one of the most significant episodes in a person's life, and it's extremely disruptive, and in a way I would suggest it's just this biographical and bodily disruption which prompts a strong urge to communicate the experience to others. Now, there could be various reasons for wanting to communicate the experience. You may be trying to share the individual, ineffable quality of it, or you may be trying to show what is intersubjective about it, to provide a guide, so to speak, for other people who may have the same disease later. And I think that is what has created kind of genres associated with particular illnesses. Breast cancer narratives have gone through a big cycle of development since they first emerged onto the scene, likewise with HIV and AIDS. Now, I'm not as concerned with these genres which seek to act as guides or agitate for political change. So, what is it I found interesting was the limits of language, the limits of narrative, which the illness experience reveals. And this is tied very much to the conventions of literary realism, which much literature and much of our talk abides by. So I'll just give you a very short definition of literary realism, and then I'll show you how that is surpassed in one of my favorite illness narratives. So this is someone called Pam Morris writing. Realism is an optimistic belief that human beings can adequately reproduce by means of verbal and visual representations both the objective world that is exterior to them and their own subjective responses to that exteriority. So, as I previously mentioned, there are two things about serious illness that can cause problems for this kind of model of communication. The first is the biographical disruption, and here we could also say there are diseases that damage the person's memory or ability to communicate, such as Alzheimer's. There may also be gaps in consciousness due to illness or medications. I'm not so interested in those in the example I'm going to go into today, but rather the fact of physical pain and how resistant physical pain is to being expressed in language, and the extremely strange situation that creates. And I have here another book by Elaine Scarry called The Body in Pain, where she describes this paradox of pain very well. For the person in pain, so incontestably and unnegotiably present is it that having pain may come to be thought of as the most vibrant example of what it is to have certainty, while for the other person, it is so elusive that hearing about pain may exist as a primary model of what it is to have doubt. Thus, pain comes unshareably into our midst, as at once that which cannot be denied and that which cannot be confirmed. Now, Scarry goes on to talk about those members of society who may take it upon themselves to speak on behalf of people suffering pain. One example she has is those individuals who have suffered torture in tyrannical regimes, so organizations such as Amnesty International. But a more obvious group even perhaps is the medical community. But here she notes that many patients reach the opposite conclusion and find that nurses and doctors struggle to hear the voice of the person in pain and see them rather as an unreliable narrator to be bypassed as they try to access the physical events themselves. This leaves another province where one may find some guide to what it is to have pain, some suitable verbal representation, and that is the realm of literature. And here, Scarry notes, there is a paucity of fine writing because, as has already been noted, physical pain is just so difficult to turn into words. Now, one of these rare works which does successfully convey the experience of physical pain is this, Denton Welch's A Voice Through a Cloud, published posthumously. And in this book, he recounts his experiences after suffering devastating injuries, after being knocked from his bicycle by a car, and he, in his words, finds he'd strayed into a nightmare land where I had no part or place. Like Alice, I had burrowed down a rabbit hole to find myself in a world of twisted sight, sound, taste, and touch. What this creates is a situation where, in this book, we have two worlds coexisting side by side and unable, really, to communicate successfully with one another. There is the intersubjective world, which, as I said, is tied to the conventions of literary realism, where we believe that we are capable of verbally communicating everything which happens to us to others. And then there is this other world that is full of novel experiences that happen only to the individual and cannot be turned easily into language. But Welch's genius is to shuttle between them, and so we can see both of them at once. And so here, I'll read you a few passages, and the first will be his description of physical pain. It goes like this. "But nurse, I can't go to sleep," I said, suddenly terrified of being left alone for the night. "You must try." It was horrible. They were going to abandon me, and my legs were bristling and burning, and I could not move them, and my head was throwing out waves of black sickness, which seemed about to drown me. I began to talk to the nurses wildly. I asked them questions. I told them things. I laughed and smiled, and all the time I knew that they were watching me and judging me. They were not taking anything I said seriously. Then the pain, like some huge grizzly bear, seemed to take me between its paws. I screamed from sheer shock at its sudden increased violence. "Stop it," the nurses said together. "You'll wake the others." They seemed about to stifle me if I dared to make another sound. I must have screamed again, for all I can remember is a shriek and a pain invading my whole body. The shriek seemed to be following the pain into every limb. I was nothing but a shriek and a pain. I was sweating. Everything was wet. I was crying. Saliva dribbled out of my mouth. In the middle of the furnace inside me, there was a clear thought, like a text in cross stitch. I wanted to warn the nurses, to tell them that nothing was real but torture. Nobody seemed to realize that this was the only thing on earth. People didn't know that it was waiting for them quietly, patiently. I felt that if I bore the agony a moment longer, it would split my skin. It was such a growing and powerful thing. It would burst out of the tightness of my body. So, as I said, we see here the two things side by side. We see the intersubjective world where the nurses simply want the screaming patient to be quiet, supposedly out of concern for others. And we also see the inner content of the experience and how powerful it is, and yet there's no one really there to bear witness to it. Welch, with his genius, as I say, takes matters into his own hands and provides us with this account, which he wrote as he was dying himself. He could only write for 3 or 4 minutes at a time. He was in such incredible pain and he was taking morphine daily. But he was intent on finishing his account. Sadly, A Voice Through a Cloud was never completed, but enough of it remained to provide this testament to his experience. Now, another passage I'd like to read to you doesn't concern physical pain, but it shows us how Welch verbally represents this twisted world, as he calls it, and he uses a literary technique that the Russian formalist Viktor Shklovsky called defamiliarization, and I'll just provide you with his definition. He said, after we see an object several times, we begin to recognize it. The object is in front of us and we know about it, but we do not see it. Hence, we cannot say anything about it. Art removes objects from the automatism of perception in several ways. Okay, so bear that in mind as I now read to you this passage from Welch. He's in an ambulance and he's being taken to his new place of residence, a convalescent home on the English coast. And this is what he writes. Everything was different. The sound of the car's engine was muted. It was no more than a soft purring. When a tram passed, it did not clank and lurch as I had expected. It glided noiselessly, like a skater on ice or a swan on silky water. And the people inside, they had dark, staring, liquid eyes, like the eyes in portraits on the lids of late Egyptian mummy cases. Their hair seemed dusty and still, unblown. They grasped their shopping bags unfeelingly as children hold their dolls. With deep, thoughtful faces, they went about their almost sacred household tasks, keeping strict silence. Close to a pink-grey wall, where every brick seemed to jump out at me separately, I heard music from a wireless or a barrel organ. We were travelling slowly, and for a moment the music wrapped me round. It must have been loud music, but it came to me as a spidery tinkle, filtered through a thousand cobwebs, or the sound of some mermaid blowing on her comb in a cave under the sea. It seemed as beautiful and far away as that. This passage really gives us the sense of encountering the world for the first time, but it's not the shared, intersubjective world we're all able to agree upon as the real world when we're well, but it's this world that each of us enters as individuals and experiences there alone for ourselves. We are very lucky that Welch was able to provide his account for us, so we followed him down the rabbit hole. There are many ways that writers have sought to represent the disruption caused by the experience of serious illness. I just wanted to show you one way today in the work of Denton Welch. In a future video, I'll look at Thomas Bernhard and how he approaches the problem in his biography. But until then, I must say my farewells. I do apologize that the first part of this video was rather noisy out on the balcony. That's why I came inside for the conclusion. All right, I must repeat my mantra. Be safe, be strong, and until the next time, nanu nanu.